Hello and welcome to another week of The Kickoff. I'm Tim Morgan, and help guide me through this football frenzy we've got at the moment, former Matildas captain Melissa Barbieri. Barbs, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
You've been everywhere on social media this week. Obviously, massive milestone, 25 years in pro football, plenty of highs, Asian Cup, Olympics. Few lowlights, though. The Crockenbush story was getting around on Twitter. Please tell me more.
No, the Crockenbush. I went to a lot of effort one year for a New Year's party and nobody turned up. And I had a 30-person Crockenbush that I made from scratch. But, yeah, no one there to actually... So no matter how many trophies you win, people still don't turn up to your New Year's party. And I got left with the Crockenbush, but it was yummy. That's all that matters.
Hopefully, A, people turned up to your celebrations this week, and B, maybe we can get the Crockenbush photos and there's a job on Celebrity MasterChef for you maybe after this.
I don't mind it. I think the bake-off is for me, the Australian Celebrity Bake-Off. I'll give that a go.
Now, 25 years, you started playing football before I knew my ABCs. But at 42, have you learnt how to protect your head yet? Because the last couple of weeks, as we can see here, you've just been absolutely copping it.
You know, I like to put my body on the line for my teammates, and my captain certainly is, you know, selling me under the bus a couple of times. But no, I do say to the young goalkeepers out there, you've got to put your body on the line but know when to tuck and roll.
We've got another bit of vision here. I want to know, in your illustrious career, have you ever quite saved like this? Penalty shootout and
boom. Boom. Save's a save, mate. That's all that matters. It doesn't matter how you do it. I actually think I've done a few like those, but it's in training mostly. And it's mostly one day before a major game.
Thankfully, the A-League nets are a little bit more sturdy. They don't fall over.
Yeah, you don't take them with you if you fall into them.
Before we get into this week's ends action, I want to speak about the football frenzy because every club's going to be dealing with it now and over the rest of the month is these short turnarounds. Is there a discussion in the locker room about what you do and different tactics you can use, or does everyone sort of just employ the same sort of theory?
So it's a little bit different for each team because each team might have a little bit more gap between games, but certainly in terms of structure and what you want your team to achieve, you might have a little bit more time to work on set pieces if you've got a longer week, but those things go out the window straight away once you have that quick turnaround, and it's basically about recovery. Knowing your players, who can back up the next week, and pretty much having this roster. And the teams that actually have the most depth in their bench are the teams that are going to do well throughout this period.
Well, one team that has plenty of depth is Melbourne City, and that's where we're going to start Friday night with them taking on the Western Sydney Wanderers. You've played under Patrick Kisnorbo. Yeah. How would he be handling sitting at home with COVID watching his team play?
I think, you know, that's the benefit of PK is that he has a lot of good people around him. So he wouldn't be worried, but I know he'd be frenetic because he likes to have control over everything, and he's a real stand-up coach when it comes to things. He's got his finger on the dial in every training session. He's not one to say, OK, Checky, you take over today, or he's in everything, he's running everything, but he has so much support around him that he knows the team's in capable hands.
They looked pretty good against Newcastle, probably one of their best in terms of how that attacking three has worked. Do you think they get the job done against the Wanderers?
I certainly think they do. Rudan probably has some kinks to work out with his new team, but PK is one of the people that he likes to play great football. He likes to have depth on the bench. So he's been building his squad for over the two seasons now. And I think it's probably the best I've seen in terms of how they've played in that last game against Newcastle. So there's no reason why they can't step it up against Western Sydney Wanderers.
Saturday afternoon, we do have Wellington Phoenix up against Adelaide United. The Phoenix playing in front of no fans, yet still three wins on the trot. How are they doing it?
It's kind of hard, isn't it? They're a resilient bunch. Ufuk Tale has them in a well-oiled machine. I think the longevity of the team that's been in a bubble bodes well for them. I think a lot of the other teams may have had that luxury of being at home and having some sort of normality. But these boys have been on the road for so long. Even the women's team, they've been doing great. They know what their role is, they know what they have to do to get through, and they are able to stay away from COVID because of it, because they're really full out-and-out professionals.
On to the Saturday night game, Melbourne Victory up against Newcastle. Obviously, Victory go down following the FFA Cup clash. Was that simply a hangover and you expect them to bounce back here against the Jets?
I don't think it's a matter of a hangover. I think it's about that quick turnover. They only had two or three days in between that match, and then they lost a few really senior players. They had two youngsters starting in the lineup, and it's just a matter of how well these three players can come back. Sporanovic especially. Cruz is also one of those ones that leads the top line. So how they can, you know, recover from that game is what's going to put them in good stead against Newcastle. And I think it'll be tough for Victory to back it up. It's going to be a difficult one, but Newcastle travelling, once again, that does impact recovery.
A lot of chat about the Popolution.
Yeah.
Will it be a short-lived one? Because suddenly there's talk, Tony Popovic, Socceroos manager. Can you see that playing out, and how quickly could you see it play out?
I think he's a good option. Don't get me wrong, but I think there are certain types of coaches that are national team coaches, people who like that break in between games, and man management is a little bit different. But then you've got your hands-on coaches, and I really think Popovic likes to pick a player out of obscurity in Japan and bring them over, and someone out of Europe and bring them into their team. You can't do that with a national team. You have to... You're basically given what you're given, and you can't create players. I really think he loves that mentoring and building players from scratch or tweaking players, and I'm not sure you can get that with a national team program. So, you know, as I think he'd do a great job, but maybe he's not that type of coach.
Interesting to see, especially if the Socceroos don't make the World Cup. But let's get on to the other game that is Saturday night. Sydney FC against Western United. This is first v third. Are both these teams that good?
They are. I actually think they are very good. You know, Sydney's always up there. And it's probably the first time, you know, Western United fans have seen themselves at the top. And I love the fact that John Aloisi is just, you know, riding the wave. He's not getting ahead of himself. He's making sure his players know that this is about building culture. And the wins are coming, but it's almost by accident. You know, those 1-0 wins are coming nearly every week. They lost an opportunity to win a game the other day. And although he was upset about it, he knows it's the bigger picture, and he's not getting ahead of himself quite that early. And Sydney FC, for me, have been a little bit lacklustre. They'll be raring to go.
So on to Sunday afternoon, Central Coast against Perth Glory. Realistically, what do we expect from Perth, who have had COVID go through the team?
It's incredibly unfortunate that they have had such a long time, you know, off in the beginning because of the border closures, and then for them to finally start playing, and then the hope of them playing in Perth really broke their hearts, and then they succumbed to the fact that they'll have to play in the eastern states, and now to have COVID. And as much as you know that COVID is going to come into the team, you don't actually know what COVID is going to do to the players.
O'Neill spoke this week. He mentioned he was struggling with his lungs working back at the first training, so hard to know how they'll pull up. Sunday night, Brisbane Roar, MacArthur. They've really struggled, the Bulls, haven't they, since they've come back, didn't play all of January. Have they got the tactics wrong?
No, I don't think it's the tactics. I think it's the sharpness. It's that, you know, 1-2 play, that combination play. Milicic, you know, he loves players getting up and down the sidelines, and you know those sorts of things comes with extra games and more game time, so that break for them really, you know, downplayed what they're capable of, but in saying that, he's also changing his tactics in order to play three games in 9 days, rather than saying, okay, we're playing in this game, we're playing right now, what do I need to do to win? He's actually thinking ahead to the next two games, which is unfortunate for us watching the games, because some of his best players get taken off because they can't back it up and they are worried about risk and injury. And I can understand that so early in the season, but really, games are going to tick over pretty quickly and you'll be halfway through the season and not have enough.
Melissa, thank you so much for your time and your insights, and good luck to your City women as well this week.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
So there you go. Plenty of football coming this week. And then after that as well, it's a football frenzy. And of course, you can catch it all on Network 10 and Paramount+.